Next up is Dean Liu, who is a first time reader, so thank you for being here. Been reading since 7 years old.
Oh, but not here. Okay, yeah.
This reading is brought to you by Jerry Jones. Before I start, if anyone has any questions, go ahead and give me those. All right. Good. Good to hear. Thank you so much for your correct pronunciation of my name. It's more than I deserve. A few years ago, people started saying it Daniel, and I lost the energy to correct them, and so that's what I became. Keeping with the prompt of today's reading, these poems have no particular theme whatsoever. The first one is called Scrambled Corn. These were premium channels, late nights in the late 90s, spreading towards my parents' door across the living room. But there, a boob in the upper left corner could be matched with the lower half, diagonal on screen and remembered later. The lime greens and pinks, harsh colors, saturated and skewed. All the women as fluid as genies fresh from bottles, often indistinct edges. But that's what we had. On channel 17 or 21, Cinemax and Showtime, the swirled figures, shaky images, somewhat sickening. Like wearing the wrong glasses. I'd look for repetitious movement as the tube spun. I think they're on a boat. And maybe he just gave her a massage. I think she's probably beautiful. I just bet. I find that if you're going to litter, if you need to litter, and everybody needs an outlet, if you just like set something on the ground lovingly and kind of pat it, even if it's trash, people won't like report you. This poem is called Cursing for Kids. In the beginning was the word, which made sense because words weren't just spoken meaning. They were more. They were things in our heads. They were passwords, spells. And the wrong ones could get mouths filled with soap, a check on the board, endless suspension. So we had softcore versions of words we weren't to use. Shucks, shikes, shite, shoot, even shnikes. We'd yell like some bee chip inside kept us right. Fudge it, freak you, motherfunker. We're crying out loud. Criminy, Jimmy Cricket, crikey, crap, dang, darn, durn, golly, geez, gosh, heck, holy cow. And there were hybrids of shucky darn, gull darn, and others that came from some nowhere, like dog my cats. Then in children's church, we heard these words were just as bad as those they replaced. Well, fuck, we all thought. Gosh, help us. We didn't know what to say. Thank you. You were exactly kind enough. This poem's called Cumulatively. Whatever shit you're in, consider all the love. Blatant and sidelong. All love that bounced off in a rush. Every crush unknown for years. The unrequited. Old love like an undershirt gone beige, wrapping your chest. A brightness in the ribcage, this love, collected from people dead or on their way. From pets slobbering it or kneading bread on your lap, and maybe too this steady earth that spins so yet keeps us close. Unsaid affection smiles overtly, or early love, the woman who packed lunch in little compartments of a box thousands of days I grew up on. And any maintenance man fixing into the night, or the one who returned a couple of hundreds found in my wallet on the gravel. I've been blindsided by kindness in the daily mess. When someone merely speaks a different speed into your hurt, a slow patience that catches you up like a child in the arms of their words, good words. Add every pat on the back and attaboy. Look at it comprehensively, the incomprehensible decency of some days. Even my insurer, the birthday cards a receptionist sends, signed by the boss, or the clerk when you're 3 cents short, sure he has the difference in the drawer. Think of love, all its collected effects, its inheritance. Against all the jarring and disbelief, if you tend to dwell, return also to these. Shake the memories awake like it's Christmas morning. That was a serious one. There will be a brief intermission between this, that poem and the next. All right. Welcome back. I hope you had time to stretch your legs. Something to drink. This is called Carry Me. Anyone who can fireman lift me, heft me on your back if I'm limited. When dumb, take up where I can't. Tote me on the back pegs of your bike. In anger, call me out of it. Don't mind the hate on my face or whatever I might be muttering. Pull me to safety with an arm linked under like a good lifeguard. Yell for help if you have to. Call an adult. Remember your CPR training, trust exercises, and late night infomercials. Talk me down. Make sure I keep my weight off it. Offer up authors you like and put forth advice that'll leave me taken aback. Correct me when I'm flat. Sing loud because I can't read sheet music, and we are a human choir. Pick me up inexplicably, like Elijah in a whirlwind. Sorry. You really don't want to mess up the last word of a poem. That's just advice in the future. Well, I said like Elijah in a woodwind, but it's supposed to be in a whirlwind, which would be a better biblical reference. Where's the podium? I almost brought my own podium. I thought, that's stupid. You don't bring your own podium. They have one there for you. Don't. Even if you have a favorite podium, leave it at home. Oh. Okay. See, I worry about glass facades like this. I've been worried about satin my whole life. We don't have to go into this. Finding kittens. Better than Easter eggs, they were year-round and lively. A movable holiday. As kids, we chance upon their muse. Great news, half heard, the wind brought, and haphazard gusts across the salvage yard or by the barn. Hidden harder than hard-boiled numbers by mothers who looked on us with resignation. Plotting the next cachet, they mouth their horse forward, one at a time as we gone. But the bounty, a spectrum of kittens in high grass. The calico, the gray, the black one, with eyes still mucus shut. Mama cat mining the periphery. She deftly managed, kitten mouth, and slipped the cleft in the skirting of a mobile home. But we find them again, and move them ourselves to a basket on the porch. The claws that couldn't break our skin, mole-faced new ones questing for a nibble. We'd eye-drop dots of milk into yawning maws. Many things we couldn't do, but kittens were a game smallness found favorable. Shimmied in crawl spaces, reaching into stacks of cinder blocks, coming out with fistfuls of kittens. This is called Sundays. If there's catching up to do, what we need is Sunday. Sundays, really. Several in a row. The calendar tipped on its side, and four or five Sabbaths smiling back is in a group photo. Consecutive late mornings offering a little more sleep, love, and memories of what was good about church, because there was good. Human beings in their gathered voices, strong and soft, often singing off key, having packed all their best intentions into dress shirts and flower dresses. Babies crying because they can. But for this Sunday, the Sunday of this poem, clean the place if cleaning helps you think. Follow a to-do list like its commandments. Call someone who will answer. Check the sky for a God who's as much there as he ever was. I began pen pals with former poet laureate Donald Hall a couple years ago. I stopped writing to him because he's so nice he would never stop writing to me. But each of his letters started coming on smaller and smaller stationery because he's like 87 years old and near death. But this poem is about he and his deceased wife, who his poems have been about her for 20 years now. And she was also a poet, Jane Kenyon. I checked out her collected poems with his last summer, read them together, tending to go at her slower, wanting more than 47 years of poetry. It's life in a farmhouse. Looking out a kitchen window at light that passes through clouds and leaves as he reads the newspaper like a map. His has become a poetry of loss. Over and over, she dies in it. And dying, did she know how long he'd write her? I feel for him. I've always known I'd be the last to go, have to clean up after, shut up all the lights in the place, and drive home through dark. He sits alone, serving out the uncertain sentence of survivor, with as much of a ghost as anyone, the shape of her in all her clothes. Again, hears her whisper Perkins from an upper room. I finished his work weeks before, but kept it until I'd read all of Kenyon. Not to reread it, but so I could return the two of you together. I was also pen pals with a death row inmate for a while. He stopped writing back abruptly. This poem's called On Prayer. Think of people praying in their way all over the world. Prayer circling God like a beehive. Think of thunder rattling the window panes, the stacks of dishes. Think of faded hands pressed flat in a framed oval over a dining room table. Think of people reaching up, as though out from water, for a lifeguard who may or may not come. How much time is spent on human prayer? Prayer is like heads down, thumbs up, waiting for God's unseen tap. Prayer is hope with agenda. And whatever God is, an idea or some unmarked leftovers, a personal Lord and Savior, a passing craze, or a homeroom teacher looking on as death plays tag with our friends. If God is, I hope God enjoys us. Enjoys the dog dragging its rear like a paintbrush across the carpet, drag queens taking themselves into something else, the dancers crumping or clowning. Enjoys my fat family consuming a Sunday buffet like he eats prayer constantly. He's been stuffed with the stuff since creation came. And this is my last poem. It's called Haircuts. They were abusive. My mom cut my hair growing up. The way to handle any animal buzzing that kind of noise is not to. I think of bumblebees, bees in a rattler's tail. These mean to be left alone, as those electric shears should have been, to rust in peace from too many wet haircuts years before, and not taken to our soft spots or around the ears where the shears would lock up and tear the hair out. It was an angry, toothy beast my mom would laugh off, knock on the heel of her palm, and continue on. She was saving $5, which is a good thing on its own. She'd adjust the blade with a butter knife, turn the big screw, and if it grabbed again, she said it was because I jerked my head. At times, I couldn't breathe during haircuts. Those double D's still haunt me. Sometimes the clippers would go fortissimo, and no amount of knocking on palm, on countertop, would dim them. These haircuts were slanderous. They said awful things about me. But I preferred all the haircuts she gave to the ones she gave up on. Said the clippers were done, left one side cut, one side not. Thank you.